Hello, I'm Michaela van der Schaar, and it is my great pleasure to give this invited talk in the ICML 2021 workshop on interpretable machine learning in healthcare. Today I'm going to discuss quantitative epistemology, which is a new field of research pioneered by our lab aimed at conceiving a new human-machine partnership. I would like to start by thanking my PhD student, Alihan Huyuk, who has greatly contributed to this research agenda. Sir William Osler, the father of modern medicine, said, "If it were not for the great variability between individuals, medicine might as well be a science, not an art." And indeed, more than 100 years later, medicine remains more of an art rather than a science. So it is the goal of our research lab to develop cutting-edge machine learning methods aimed at turning medicine from art to science. We develop machine learning methods that can enable medicine to go to the next level beyond precision medicine into what we call bespoke medicine. Machine learning methods that can empower healthcare professionals as well as patients, improve systems, pathways, and processes in healthcare, enhance population health and public health policies, and catalyze new discoveries. At ICML 2021, we presented a variety of machine learning methods for medicine. For instance, we gave a tutorial on synthetic data generation in healthcare. We discussed several analytics, including individualized treatment effect inference, both in the static as well as the dynamic setting. And we have also introduced a new research frontier in machine learning interpretability by providing mechanisms for the first time to understand black box time series models. But today I'm going to discuss quantitative epistemology, which is this new field of research we have worked on over the past few years aimed at understanding and empowering humans. And quantitative epistemology interacts with all these other research pillars of our lab and enhances them. So what does quantitative epistemology stand for? Epistemology is the study of knowledge, and quantitative refers to things that can be measured. While current machine learning focuses on conventional decision-making analysis with the focus of either replacing and outperforming humans, or using decision support systems to guide humans, the focus of our work on inverse decision modeling is to understand humans with the overall goal of empowering them. So we use machine learning methods to understand, explain, and audit decisions, give quantitative accounts of past behavior, identify suboptimal behavior, variation in practice, as well as provide guidance that can improve policies. While today I'm going to give examples from how inverse decision modeling can be used to empower clinicians, this overall agenda is useful beyond medicine in many other areas where humans need to make quantitative decisions. And the quantitative epistemology agenda goes beyond just inverse decision modeling, which I'm going to discuss in detail today. In quantitative epistemology, we aim to create a new partnership between humans and machines. We develop machine learning methods that can help humans acquire better information to inform their decisions. We can direct them towards the right information to consider. We can help humans evaluate and integrate different complex sources of information in order to turn them into more accurate decisions. We develop machine learning methods to learn various knowledge representations that humans use and identify each individual's internal knowledge model such that we can best use that knowledge to empower them. But quantitative epistemology can also enable humans to better interact with each other in a more quantitative and exact way. Also, it can help humans learn over time. So while the standard machine learning agenda focuses on developing machine learning models that can replace humans or outperform humans, for instance, in the clinical setting by issuing predictions and decisions instead of humans. The focus of this research agenda is to learn how humans make decisions, for instance, by studying the work of Daniel Kahneman, System 1 and 2, and incorporating this knowledge into the design of more human-like machine learning methods that can replace and outperform humans. Another part of the research agenda, the current research agenda, is focused on standard decision support, where machine learning methods are used to guide and support human decision making. And a lot of our former research has focused on this research agenda. However, we would like now to go one step further through inverse decision modeling by understanding how humans make decisions and use information about their past behavior, suboptimal behavior, variation in practice in order to inform future decisions. So this provides surface level analysis and insight into human decision making with the overall goal of empowerment rather than replacement. In the quantitative epistemology agenda, we envision a new human-machine partnership. In this way, machine learning can understand the root cause of variation in practice. We can build internal models for each individual. It can flag potentially useful information. It can identify new ways to learn, thereby extracting actionable meaning from analysis of decision making. Also, we are creating in this way a feedback loop. We use knowledge about how humans learn and make decisions extracted using machine learning to help humans learn and make better decisions in the future. This is not only useful for decision makers such as clinicians, but also for researchers, for instance, clinical researchers, by identifying new hypotheses and enable them to make new discoveries. So we are envisioning a paradigm shift from the current decision support systems where decision makers are provided with prediction outcomes, forecasts, actionable intelligence, and also where decision support system may be able to detect one-time mistake of decision makers, and information is provided to the decision maker before they issue their decisions, into quantitative epistemology, where we have a continuous cycle of interaction between humans and machines. For instance, in this case, decision makers are not only able, not only provided with information about possible one-time mistakes they may make, but also machine learning can analyze and present information about potential systematic errors that these humans may do. It may validate internal intended decisions. It can enable humans to become more aware of their decisions and the basis on which they issue these decisions, including enabling them to avoid cognitive biases. It may also recommend to them when training is needed. So quantitative epistemology, unlike decision support systems of today, are interacting with humans continuously. Quantitative epistemology can also help stakeholders of all sorts, such as patients, understand reasoning behind the decision. Supervisors and managers detect systematic errors and analyze variation in practice and monitor behavior. Policymakers assess current practice and measure the impact of new policies. And trainers and teachers find better ways to represent information and empower humans to learn more effectively and continuously. And last but not least, as I mentioned before, researchers to analyze behavioral data, form hypotheses, and contribute to decision-making theory. We have done quite some work on quantitative epistemology so far over the last few years. And we have looked at how timely is agent decision-making, where agents here are humans. What reward function does the agent optimize? How important are various counterfactuals in making decisions? What are subjective beliefs of the agent? How optimal is the agent behavior to an ideal reward function? How does an agent's behavior evolve over time? And we have created the inverse decision modeling framework, which is a general framework that encompasses all these different types of analysis. So in inverse decision modeling, our motivation is the fact that human decision making is not always perfect, mainly due to the boundness of human rationality and the cognitive biases they have. When this is the case, we then ask the question, how can we help humans make better decisions? Of course, correcting any imperfections in human decision making first requires identifying those imperfections in a quantitative manner. In order to address this, we propose inverse decision modeling, which is essentially a framework for learning interpretable representations of decision-making behavior. Importantly, it enables us to describe existing behavior of an agent relative to what we might consider as ideal behavior. This, in turn, makes it possible for us to identify the imperfections we aim to address. In order to see how inverse decision modeling, or for short IDM, achieves that, first consider the conventional ways of analyzing decision making. The forward problem is concerned with what constitutes ideal behavior. It starts with some sort of task representation. For instance, in the standard reinforcement learning setup, this task representation could be a reward function that we want to maximize. Then it outputs the optimal behavior that best achieves the represented task. The inverse problem, on the other hand, aims to describe what the existing behavior looks like. It starts with the behavior itself and works backwards to obtain a representation that explains how that behavior has come to be. However, solutions for neither problem offer much help to us in understanding human decision-making. While the forward solution ignores nuances of human behavior completely, inverse solution mostly focus on imitating human behavior rather than understanding and improving it. IDM is a type of inverse analysis that infers a representation from the existing behavior as well. But in order to do so, it leverages solutions to the forward problem as a theoretical benchmark. We refer to the particular forward solution considered as our normative ideal. Essentially, it describes what we think is the best way to solve the decision-making problem at hand. Since the behavior representation obtained by IDM is given with respect to this normative ideal, we can easily use it to generate prescriptive advice for humans that would guide them towards our normative ideal. This advice could come in the form of new clinical practice guidelines, for instance. On the basis of this new advice and new guidelines, the existing behavior would, of course, change, after which we can use IDM again to infer a representation of that new behavior and issue new advice. In this way, we can keep improving human behavior through a feedback cycle. We start by considering the standard decision-making setup. Here, at each step, the agent is in some internal state Z, and on the basis of the internal state, they take an action according to some decision policy. Then, their actions causes the environment to transit into a new external state S and emit an observation that is indicative of this new external state. Finally, the agent updates their internal state as well on the basis of that observation according to some recognition policy. We refer to any information that is relevant to the agent in planning their behavior as the planning parameters. For instance, in the standard reinforcement learning setup, the utility function that the agent aims to maximize would be a planning parameter. Another planning parameter could be the discount factor they use. We also refer to the distribution of actions and observation induced by the agent's policies as the agent behavior. Then, a forward planner aims to find a behavior that would optimize an objective determined by a given set of planning parameters. Again, in the standard reinforcement learning setup, that objective could be the expected cumulative utility. Now, suppose we are given demonstration of the agent's existing behavior. Moreover, suppose we partition the planning parameters into a normative and a descriptive part. Then, an inverse planner aims to find the descriptive part of the planning parameters given the normative parameters, such that the behavior induced by the two is as close as possible to the demonstrated behavior. A better way to conceptualize this operation is to think of it as the projection of the demonstrated behavior onto the space of behaviors that all satisfy the same normative standards. And in our framework, those normative standards are specified in the form of a forward planner and a fixed set of normative planning parameters. What we have been calling as inverse decision modeling so far is essentially this projection operation. However, this formulation not only subsumes a wide range of existing algorithms, but it also opens up new possibilities for interpretative research on decision-making behavior. In order to see how to consider inverse reinforcement learning within the general framework of inverse decision modeling, let us consider a forward planner as in the standard reinforcement learning planning, where we have no normative parameters. In turn, we seek to infer the utility function of the agent as our descriptive parameter. Essentially, inverse reinforcement learning asks the following question. What would be the utility function that the agent maximizes if they were indeed maximizing a reward function? Using IDM, we can ask, though, even more interesting questions than this. For instance, suppose we already know a utility function that we expect to be optimal. We might want to investigate how rational an agent appears to be in pursuing that utility function. Here, the ideal utility function would be a normative parameter that we specify rather than a descriptive parameter that we infer. Instead, our descriptive parameters would be the various measures of rationality that we can come up with. In fact, we investigate this question even further and develop what we call inverse rational bounded control. This requires us to describe a bounded rational planner as part of our normative specification. We will assume that the agent has uncertain knowledge of the environment, which is given as a prior over the transition and emission dynamics. However, we will allow the agent to deviate from this prior based on their internal state according to some specification policy. Assuming that the agent would have performed Bayesian inference as their recognition policy if they were to know their environment perfectly, the overall recognition of the agent would be considered as an aggregate of such inferences weighted according to their specification policy. Then, the bounded rational planner aims to maximize the expected cumulative utility, much like in the standard reinforcement learning planning, but this time with additional constraints on how much the agent's decision, specification, and recognition policies can deviate from the pre-specified prior. The motivation behind these constraints is that human rationality is similarly bounded. Solving that optimization leads us to a value iteration rule that is familiar from reinforcement learning, except with additional complexity terms discouraging deviations from prior decision, specification, and recognition policies. We take how freely the agent can deviate from the prior decision policy as a measure of their flexibility, how freely they can deviate from prior specification policy as a measure of their optimism, and how freely they can deviate from prior recognition policies as a measure of their adaptivity. In order to see the impact of these factors on behavior, we consider a simple environment for medical diagnosis. This is, of course, a stylized environment, where patients are either disease negative or disease positive, and vital sign measurements are taken every step noisily, indicating the patient's underlying disease state. Then, the decision-making clinician needs to determine whether to keep monitoring the patient and collect more evidence for a diagnosis, or to stop and declare a final diagnosis that is either negative or positive. Our normative specification of the utility function is such that correct diagnoses are awarded a utility of 10, while incorrect diagnoses are awarded minus 36, and the cost of continuing to monitor the patient for one more step is minus 1. In this figure, we see the effect of flexibility on behavior. Here, the x-axis represents the clinician's subjective posterior over their patient's true disease state, and the red markers show how that posterior is updated as more positive observations are made. Note that in both cases, when the clinician is a little bit more than 80% confident in the diagnosis, they are more likely to stop monitoring the patient and declare a final diagnosis. However, the actions of the inflexible agent, it's much more stochastic as compared to the very flexible agent. This is related to the concept of behavioral inconsistency in psychology. In the next figure, we examine the effect of optimism on behavior. While the optimistic agent believes observations to be much more informative than they actually are and update their subjective posterior accordingly, the pessimistic agent believes them to be less informative. This is related to the phenomena of over and under reaction. In the last figure, we see the effect of adaptivity on behavior. The non-adaptive agent requires less evidence before they declare a final diagnosis compared with the adaptive agent. This is related to the concepts of base rate neglect and confirmation bias. Now that we have described a bounded rational planner, we can return back to our original question. How rational does an agent appear to be in pursuing an ideal utility function? We can formulate inverse bounded rational control as an instance of IDM to answer this question. Our forward planner will be the bounded rational planner we have just defined, and our normative parameters are the utility functions that we consider to be ideal given the decision-making problem we analyze. Our descriptive parameters are the measures of flexibility, optimism, and adaptivity we have just discussed. As an example, we are indeed able to infer how flexible an agent is using inverse bounded rational control. Next, we tackle a more challenging task. First, notice how non-adaptive and optimistic behaviors are very similar to each other from the perspective of an outside observer. Both agents declare a final diagnosis after making only two observations, which is earlier than what a perfectly rational agent would do. However, while non-adaptive agents behave this way due to confirmation bias, the optimistic agents behave in the same way due to overreaction to new evidence. Inferring adaptivity and optimist parameters together using inverse bounded rational control, we are able to differentiate between these two types of apparently similar behaviors. However, making the same distinction using inverse reinforcement learning is not possible. If we try to infer the effective utility function of the agent as if they are perfectly rational, we get pretty much the same behavior for both cases. The inferred utility function punishes incorrect diagnosis less than our normative specification of minus 36, which is consistent with non-adaptive as well as optimistic agents declaring behaviors earlier than ideal. However, in this case, we are unable to identify the underlying reason behind such behavior, unlike in inverse bounded rational control. We also go one step further to illustrate our method in a setting for diagnosing Alzheimer's disease. While an MRI is often informative of Alzheimer's, it is also financially costly. Alzheimer's progresses usually in three stages: normal function, mild cognitive impairment, and dementia, which constitute our state space. And as observations, we consider cognitive test results and MRI outcomes of patients. As a more realistic task, hence, in the context of diagnosis Alzheimer's disease, we consider the decision-making problem to be when to order an MRI during the diagnostic process and when we do not need to. Note that the MRIs are often informative of Alzheimer's behavior, but also they are costly. First, we recover the optimism parameter for all patients at once. Then, we do the same for different subgroups of patients. We see that clinicians appear to be significantly less optimistic when diagnosing patients with the APOE4 genetic risk factor, female patients, as well as patients over the age of 75, which also happen to be the patients who are more at risk of Alzheimer's. So, just to summarize, while existing work on behavioral cloning, distribution matching, inverse reinforcement learning, and partial observable IRL, as well as other forms of IRL, are only focusing on replacing, copying, and outperforming humans, in our work on inverse bounded rational control, we focus on understanding humans, understanding uncertainty, decision complexity, specification complexity, as well as recognition complexity. However, in order to further the inverse decision modeling and the quantitative epistemology agenda, we need to develop new machine learning methods. And this is what I have described today in this work on inverse bounded rational control. So I would like to invite all of you interested in clinical decision making and understanding and empowering humans to better interact with machines to consider developing new machine learning methods within the quantitative epistemology agenda. In this way, we can create a new human-machine partnership. If it is to do that during the IDM agenda, note that we have, for instance, clinicians acting and making decisions, for instance, diagnosis behavior, as I described before, and machine learning using, for instance, inverse bounded rational control can identify behavioral models, flexibility, optimism, adaptivity measures. In this way, we can unravel new hypotheses about clinical behavior. For instance, clinicians are less optimistic when diagnosing patients at risk, or optimism and confirmation bias may lead to similar but differentiable behaviors. This provides new theories of human behavior. For instance, why clinicians are less optimistic towards at-risk patients. And this can inform new machine learning models, as well as provide new advice and new clinical practical guidelines, which can be provided to further empower humans. But this can be also viewed more generally beyond inverse decision modeling. So humans make decisions and behave according to the information they have. And then we can develop new machine learning models to understand human behavior, develop behavioral models from which we can distill hypotheses about this behavior. And then through the scientific process, we can build a comprehensive and quantitative theory of human behavior, which can inform new machine learning solutions, but also can provide new guidelines and advice to humans, thereby forming a very powerful human-machine partnership. This is representing a long-term cycle, which requires analyzing behavior over time, building theories and hypotheses, and providing new advice. In a shorter term, we can create new human-machine partnerships using quantitative epistemology in an online fashion. For instance, humans can make decisions and machines can understand these decisions by building behavioral models, identifying potential biases and inconsistencies, and interpretable explanations. Then humans are provided with this information and they can inform the machine whether the adjustments and corrections that were provided about their behavior are indeed effective or not. For instance, if potential biases and inconsistencies are provided by the machine to the humans as something to consider, the humans can provide further clarifications that can improve the understanding of the machine, which can further improve the humans. And if the machine is providing interpretable explanations, humans can rate these interpretable explanations, thereby improving the understanding of the machine, which can further empower the humans. So in this way, we are able to create an online human-machine partnership in which the machine and the human are supporting each other. So quantitative epistemology is a new human-machine partnership. It's also a new field of multidisciplinary research in which machine learning can play a very important role. And we require for that a new strand of machine learning. And this is a research agenda focused on partnering with humans to empower them rather than replace them. If you are interested to read more about the quantitative epistemology agenda, please visit our website. Thank you very much.